coffee.
Aloha. I'm Jermyna van Dyken, MD. I'm a surgeon by trade, but my true passion is helping people just like you obtain and maintain optimum health. Ah, coffee. Many of us love it, and we make sure it's an important part of our morning ritual. Many of us also love other sources of caffeine like tea, cacao beans and chocolate, yerba mate leaves, and guarana. Coffee and tea are among the most popular beverages worldwide and contain substantial amounts of caffeine. But is this habit of caffeination healthy? What are the long-term effects on our overall health? Well, lucky for you, that's been studied. Most recently, it's been thoroughly evaluated in a paper published in the New England Journal of Medicine. Among its authors is Walter C. Willett, MD, the esteemed nutrition researcher from Harvard. Today, we're going to discuss this review article in depth. Hopefully, it'll give you a better understanding of the absorption and metabolism of caffeine, as well as the effects caffeine has on our overall health. Coffee and tea have been consumed for thousands of years. These beverages have become an important part of cultural traditions and social life. In addition to this, people use coffee beverages to increase wakefulness and improve work and athletic productivity. In the U.S., 85% of adults consume caffeine daily, and the average caffeine intake is 135 milligrams per day, which is equivalent to about 1.5 standard cups of coffee. But coffee and tea are not the only sources of caffeine we drink. Other beverages like energy drinks and soft drinks have caffeine and are consumed most often by adolescents, whereas coffee is consumed more frequently by adults. Different beverages have different levels of caffeine. On the high end of the spectrum would be a cup of coffee shop coffee, 235 milligrams, which is typically stronger than home-brewed coffee at 92 milligrams. Compare that to black tea, which typically has 47 milligrams of caffeine, and dark chocolate, which typically has 6 milligrams in 1 ounce. Then compare that to the ubiquitous energy drink. Some of these have the caffeine content of 5 or 6 cups of coffee in one itty-bitty little can. Let's talk about the health effects of coffee and caffeine. Concerns have long existed that coffee and caffeine may increase the risk of cancer and cardiovascular disease or heart disease, but these concerns were not really based on much evidence. More recently, evidence of health benefits have emerged. Coffee in particular is really difficult to study because in addition to caffeine, coffee contains hundreds of other biologically active compounds that we already know are healthy, like phytochemicals, polyphenols, alkaloids, melanoidins formed during roasting, magnesium, potassium, and vitamin B3. We know many of these compounds reduce oxidative stress, improve the gut microbiome, and modulate the way we metabolize sugar. Because of all this, research findings on coffee cannot be extrapolated to other caffeinated beverages. We have to interpret all coffee research, well, very cautiously. Moving on, let's briefly review caffeine metabolism. So you drink that cup of coffee. Blood levels of caffeine peak after 15 minutes and stay high for about 2 hours afterwards. Caffeine absorption is pretty much complete within 45 minutes after ingestion, and caffeine spreads rapidly throughout the body and it easily crosses the blood-brain barrier. The liver is the main metabolizer of caffeine and breaks it into small compounds which eventually get excreted in the urine. We're finding that the ability to metabolize caffeine is partly genetic. Some individuals have an inherited and genetically determined slower caffeine metabolism. In what we call a normal metabolizer, the half-life of caffeine is typically 2.5 to 4.5 hours. That means it could take 4 hours to metabolize half of the caffeine ingested, and explains why many people have difficulty sleeping if caffeine is consumed too late in the day. Caffeine affects the body in many different ways. Let's start with the brain. Caffeine has been shown to increase alertness and reduce fatigue. This is because the molecular structure of caffeine is very similar to a molecule called adenosine. Caffeine binds to the adenosine receptors in the brain and blocks adenosine, which means less fatigue, increased alertness, and reduced reaction times. Caffeine has been shown to improve vigilance during tasks that have minimal mental stimulation and take a lot of time. Things like working on assembly lines, long-distance driving, and flying. It's super important to note, though, that caffeine absolutely cannot compensate for the decline in performance after long-term sleep deprivation. What does that mean? Well, if you have one off night, like a night with less sleep, caffeine may help you compensate. But if you didn't get a good night's sleep for many nights in a row, like it's a chronic thing, you are in trouble with a capital T, and caffeine won't help you. The only thing that would help you at that point is catching up on your sleep. Adequate sleep is so, so important. Speaking of sleep, caffeine can have some interesting effects. If consumed later in the day, it takes longer to go to sleep, and on top of that, it can reduce the quality of sleep. Caffeine also causes anxiety, especially at high doses. Let's talk about caffeine and pain relief. Caffeine can contribute to pain relief when added to other commonly used pain agents like acetaminophen and ibuprofen. A review of 19 studies showed that 100 to 130 milligrams of caffeine added to an over-the-counter pain medicine increased the proportion of patients with successful pain relief. So, let's move on to our discussion of caffeine and its relationship with chronic disease. Let's start with the most common chronic disease, heart disease, or cardiovascular disease. Caffeine intake has been shown to increase blood pressure in human and animal studies. This is different from studies done on coffee. These studies seem to suggest that coffee may raise blood pressure in new users, but long-term consumption of coffee doesn't seem to have a substantial effect on blood pressure, and in some cases may even lower blood pressure. Scientists think this effect is due to a component of coffee called chlorogenic acid. This compound's thought to counteract the blood pressure-raising effect of caffeine. Let's talk about coffee and cholesterol levels. Unfiltered coffee, as you'd see in coffee prepared by French press, Turkish style, or Scandinavian boiled coffee, has been shown to increase LDL levels. In randomized trials, high consumption of unfiltered coffee, around 6 cups per day, increased LDL cholesterol by 17.8 milligrams per deciliter compared to filtered coffee, which didn't increase cholesterol levels at all. In one study, researchers estimated that this LDL increase predicted an estimated 11% higher risk of major cardiovascular events like heart attack or stroke. Turns out the unfiltered coffee contains a compound called cafestol, which is thought to be responsible for these effects. What about caffeine intake and other outcomes in relation to cardiovascular disease? Some people raise the question of coffee potentially increasing the risk of coronary artery disease and stroke. This has been studied extensively, and findings consistently indicate that consumption of up to 6 standard cups of filtered, caffeinated coffee per day, when compared to no consumption at all, is not associated with an increased risk of either condition, either in the average healthy person or in the person who has a history of hypertension, diabetes, or other cardiovascular diseases. In fact, coffee consumption was associated with a reduced risk of cardiovascular disease when compared to no coffee consumption, with the lowest risk group drinking 3 to 5 cups of coffee per day. What about caffeine and cancer? There's been many prospective cohort studies evaluating for any correlation between coffee and caffeine intake and cancer. Coffee consumption is associated with a slightly reduced risk of melanoma, breast cancer, and prostate cancer. Stronger associations are seen between coffee consumption and a lower risk of endometrial cancer and hepatocellular or liver cancer. So, does this mean that drinking coffee prevents all these cancers? Unfortunately, no. The effect is probably not strong enough, but it's good to know we can say drinking coffee doesn't really cause cancer. What about coffee consumption and stone formation in the gallbladder and the kidneys? Coffee consumption has been associated with a reduced risk of gallstones and also a reduced risk of gallbladder cancer. Coffee consumption can prevent cholesterol gallstone formation by a few mechanisms, like inhibiting the absorption of gallbladder fluid and stimulating gallbladder contraction by increasing secretion of a contractility compound called cholecystokinin, or CCK. In the U.S., one study demonstrated coffee was associated with a reduced risk of kidney stones. What about coffee intake and neurologic diseases? Multiple prospective cohort studies in the United States, Europe, and Asia have shown that caffeine intake is associated with a lower risk of Parkinson's disease. Interestingly, it's thought that the caffeine is what accounts for this risk lowering, not the other components of coffee. The reason for this is that we don't see the same risk lowering with decaffeinated coffee that we see in caffeinated coffee when it comes to Parkinson's disease. As for other neurologic diseases, coffee and caffeine consumption have also been associated with a reduced risk of depression and suicide in several cohorts. It's important to note, though, this finding did not hold in persons who have a high intake of coffee, like 8 or more cups per day. What about Alzheimer's disease, you might ask? Unfortunately, coffee consumption has not been associated with either dementia or Alzheimer's disease. So, how do we look at it with a wide-angle lens? What about all-cause mortality or death from any cause? Well, consumption of 2 to 5 cups of coffee per day has been associated with reduced mortality in cohort studies across the world. With consumption of more than 5 cups per day, the risk of death was lower than or similar to the risk of the group that had no coffee consumption at all. What's interesting in the studies, it didn't matter whether the coffee was caffeinated or decaffeinated. They were both associated with about the same amount of reduction in all-cause mortality. So, with all this discussion, can too much coffee be bad for you? Are there times when we shouldn't drink high levels of coffee? Of course there are. Some examples of this are pregnancy, if we have issues with insomnia or anxiety, or if we find we're becoming dependent on coffee. Maybe we start getting withdrawal symptoms like headache when we don't have our morning cup of coffee. That's a pretty good indicator that maybe we're drinking a little too much coffee. Caffeine does have the potential to be toxic. Just like any drug, the dose makes the poison. Yes, for those of you wondering, it's possible to fatally overdose on caffeine. A recent review of this topic revealed that caffeine poisoning from coffee and tea is quite rare because a very large amount, like 75 to 100 cups of coffee, would have to be consumed in a really short time in order for it to be fatal. Most caffeine-related deaths are due to very high doses of caffeine gotten from tablets or supplements, or they happen because a high amount of caffeine is mixed with alcohol. So try to avoid that. We have to remember, just because most studies show that for the most part caffeine has beneficial effects, this doesn't go for all caffeine. Much of the caffeine consumed happens to be in the form of energy drinks or soft drinks. These all have large amounts of added sugar, which are definitely not beneficial to health in the long run. Another example of when we should limit caffeine intake is during pregnancy. Prospective studies have shown that higher caffeine intake in the pregnant mother is associated with lower birth weight and a higher risk of miscarriage. Caffeine easily passes through the placenta and is passed from mother to fetus. Most experts suggest limiting caffeine consumption during pregnancy to a maximum of 200 milligrams per day, which is about 2 cups of home-brewed coffee. Okay, so let's wrap it up. There's quite a bit of research concluding that caffeinated coffee does not increase the risk of heart disease and certain cancers. As a matter of fact, consumption of 3 to 5 cups of coffee daily has consistently been associated with a reduced risk of several chronic diseases. That being said, too much caffeine intake can have negative effects. It's best that adults try to keep their coffee intake under 400 milligrams per day. And if pregnant or breastfeeding, 200 milligrams or less per day is recommended. Even though large studies demonstrate that moderate coffee consumption is associated with reduced all-cause mortality, there are no guidelines or recommendations that recommend caffeine or coffee intake for disease prevention. If you're not a coffee drinker or tea drinker, don't start because you want to prevent disease. But if you're a lover of coffee and tea, keep it up. It definitely can be a part of a healthy lifestyle. Just make sure to keep intake moderate, and if possible, switch from an unfiltered coffee method like a French press to filtered coffee. Your LDL cholesterol will thank you. Well, that about wraps it up for today's discussion. I certainly hope you found this information useful and practical. Links to the references used in the video are in the description below. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. If you want to show us some real support, subscribe. We love hearing from you, so please comment below with your thoughts on the video and questions you may have regarding the information provided. Thanks for watching, everyone. Stay safe, stay healthy, and aloha.